e-gaming bets, online betting for every e-sports fan. Dota 2 and Hearthstone, CSGO and Overwatch, StarCraft 2, the choice is yours. Express bets for multiple matches or live bets on the game you are watching right now. Know your way around Dota 2? Make a prediction for picks and bans. Playing CSGO? Guess the number of rounds in a certain match. Daily quests for all participants and all the best choice of payment systems. More than 600,000 users have already made their bets on the spectacular matches since 2011. EGB.com. You know for sure who's gonna win.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, welcome back to Dota Pit Season 5. We're here with Chinese Dota. We've got Ehome versus IG, and I'm Lysander. Gonna be joining you today for this BO3 broadcast. It's the group stages, and we haven't seen a couple of these teams in a while because we've been watching a lot of the qualifiers for the Boston Major. If you guys have followed me on the China Line 1, you would have seen some IG, some LGD, and lots of Ehome. Ehome K's and Ehome X's, but no Ehome Prime, as I would like to call them. So we're gonna have Old Chicken, Old Lanham, the old guys, you know, just gonna be playing on Ehome versus IG, a team that has, well, not really proven themselves as well as the other quote-unquote old squads, but we'll see how well they do. It's kind of weird not seeing Chuan on Invictus Gaming anymore, but for now, we are going to be hopping into the game. We'll see a OD and a Batrider pick. Complimentary picks, actually, or rather, the OD pick does secure that Batrider pick better because the OD is banished. It's really good against the Batrider in general, so having that taken out of the picture is always going to be good. So, alright, so Sand King as well as Oracle, I think Sand King has been seeing lots of love as of late, and I don't really blame the players from picking him up because the changes to Sand King over the years or over the patches have been just so great. The beefiness in his, the Caustic Finale, the buffing of that one, I think that made the most difference. The ability to slow in the early laning stage, just farm. And well, it's, the Aghanim's upgrade as well, you know, I'm just trying to rack my brains with all the buffs that Sand King has had, and it's just really strong for him to have that kind of late game development available to him. So I really like that out of him as well. I really do find a lot of fun playing Sand King myself in the roaming position. So I imagine the pros will have a lot more to do with him. And Oracle pick, natural counter to Batrider. I mean, there is just too many counters to Batrider, yet he's such a good hero, so... You know, in a way, he sort of forces out picks from your opponent if they want to be able to play around him. And, it's okay pick. It's got his shortcomings. It doesn't push waste out that fast. He has good burst damage. He has got good saves, got good heals. But, you know, it's a hero that really doesn't work well when there's something to take him off. You know, things like a Storm Spirit. You know, we have maybe a Ricky or Bounty Hunter. Something invisible sniping him out in the fights really limits his ability to do lifesaving. It's much like a Dazzle. You know, you don't want to be using that on yourself. So, we'll see how this Oracle plays out. I mean, right now, I want to know if there's going to be a Mirana for OP. I only saw that hero for him in the entire Boston Major qualifier. So, maybe we'll see some OP Mirana. And yeah, I do like making a lot of OP jokes. And yes, guys, I haven't solo cast in a while. You know, I've been trying to work on my dual casting and all that. And, you know, now that I'm back in the solo casting position, I'm trying to rework the amount of talking I do. And there might be some blabbering, there might be some kind of derpy talk going on. So I hope you bear with that. And it's kind of great, you know, Dota Pit, I don't believe I have casted for them before. Maybe he stood in for one or two games, but now gonna be covering their tournament for the first time. It's they've come a long way. I mean, since season one till now, I've seen lots of improvements, lots of very impressive stats. And then there we go, a Rubick pick here, a hero that is unimpressive on paper, but actually bears a lot of potential here. Being able to steal out Sand King's Barrow Strike is going to be one of his key reasons to existing in this game. And, you know, maybe stealing False Promise will be cool and everything, but I think Barrow Strike is just one of those things that Rubick just tries to steal every single time because of how powerful that ability is on him. Zero cast point, instant stun, all that good stuff. He's just really strong. And Razor. I would say Razor is just one of those heroes that can actually deal against this OD decently well. I wouldn't say he's super good. He's decent at being able to fight OD in the middle lane, being able to static link. In the past, I would say he's better, but now that Banish does damage, I'm not even sure. Maybe he goes for more points in the unstable current, being able to fight a little early. Shows that Invictus Gaming want to lean towards a more mid-game aggressive kind of stance and try and punish Ehome with the lack of wave clear, maybe. Right now, I mean, Ehome's wave clear isn't terrible, but it's just a hero that I think stands to lead up to a lot of early aggression. So right now, the important thing is whether or not we see the Sand King on the offlane role or as a support roaming kind of role, because IG might want to pick up another hero to bolster this push strat that they have coming in. With this Razor, this early fighting lineup, you need someone to push those towers in. So maybe we go back to a Chinese favorite, the Rasta. We might even go for a DK Dragon Knight. Why did I do that? DK Dragon Knight, Bottom of the Moon. But yeah, Razor could go into the safe lane, and then we have that Dragon Knight in the middle. You know, some kind of illusionary drafting. Does it make sense? You know, some kind of bait and switch. You know, thinking Razor's mid, and then you put that DK there instead. It's a very favorite Chinese thing to do. Picking up the DK as a mid lane and just push towers with it. I'm surprised it isn't a DK here. DK does decently well against OD as well. Not too good against Slop, but then with Blink Dagger and Dragon Tail, you can actually find a way to deal with Slop. But OD and Slop in general, I think, are just so good with each other. Being able to bubble the Slop when he's in deep trouble, and then just really nullifying all kinds of threats against him for 4 seconds, allowing him to go into Shadow Dance or even that Dark Pact. You know, it's just really good to have that. As a plane flies over, I think we might get distracted for a moment. But, you know, Invictus Gaming, what do they pick up here for Burning? Is it going to be that Anti-Mage? It hasn't been picked yet. I haven't seen it picked yet, but I do want to actually see how this will pan out. I mean, IG, they've got a nice lineup here, but the Anti-Mage might just, reverse that. Never mind, wind them back on that aggression clock. I guess it's not going to be rewinding of any sort. We are going to be fast forwarding. It's going to be Undying being picked up here by Invictus Gaming. So I had a lot of reservations with this hero. Faceless from C. They are undefeated with this hero. So my verdict is some teams play it better than others, and some teams just understand how to work it. I haven't actually managed to really observe and pick out the exact points where I think this hero has worked very well for another team. But I think the Undying, it could be useful here. The range on Ehome's heroes are minimal. You know, they're really short range heroes, so maybe the Tombstone gets effective here. They could pick up the Undying for the burst heals, the decay stacks early on. Try and fight again in line with this Razor pickup. Being able to dive a lot of heroes and having those decay stacks up will be good. But it still needs a bit more oomph, I think, this hero. Maybe we go for something like a Alchemist here, get Aghanim Scepters for everyone. You know, is that fallback I often see heroes go back to? You know, have that Alchemist, and then you have four Aghanim's heroes, and you can hold the high ground. You know, you can actually have some mid to late game potential. You know, the mid game, your Alchemist comes online early, you can fight pretty decent. It's not the best against slot, but it's still strong. And then you have that you have that high ground defense if things do go wrong in the early stages. Oh, it's gonna be a Husker! Oh yeah, we did not see this one coming. And now Ehome are gonna get thrown this curveball in the late stages of the game. Yes, we talk about aggression. When you go full aggression, you never come back. You know? You never ever wind down or tune it down. You just go straight into business. But looks like Ehome, they have got answers ready. They pick up the Ancient Apparition. And oh boy, this is gonna be rough. I mean, it's a hero that Husker doesn't fare too well with. I'm just gonna be very blatant about this. It is not a hero that Husker likes to see. But then again, you have that tiny window. Is it fair to say you have that tiny window where you don't have the the level 6 on AA up yet, and your Husker can go ham for maybe a couple of minutes. The first 10 minutes, I would say. AA, there's a chance the AA doesn't hit 6 by then. It's really about the timings, and Husker will have to really think about it. Does he really want to go Armlet then? Does he want to go for something else? So we'll have to see. Oracle, it's gonna be his game to save the day here. Has to build out that Husker, and all that heal is gonna be offset by this Ancient Apparition. And of course, well, it's rough. IG, they've had a rough week. Not qualifying to Boston is, I think, one of the biggest deals here. But hey, what can we say? All right, on the side of the Radiant, we have IG gonna be playing OP in the Razor. We have Undying played by Q. We have Sand King played by XXS. I've been really impressed by this guy actually so far. We've got Oracle played by Bobokar. I think my favorite name, if you come from C or Southeast Asia, Bobokar will speak volumes to you. That saying is just something else. Meanwhile, Burning is going to play Husker. Very, very fitting. Old 11 on the Dire side. Going to have Batrider burning all the trees away, doing some shenanigans. Not sure what he's actually doing. Maybe trying to snipe a courier too. Could be on the side of the mid lane. We have Old Chicken playing that Outworld Devourer. Garda on that Ancient Apparition. Lanham blinging out with the Golden Rubik Staff. And last but not least, we have Scylla playing the Slop, the dirty, dirty Slop Picker. We'll see if there are any counters to this hero, but looks like it will be a Sand King stocked on regeneration going up top. We have Razor here with this cool little lightsaber. Yeah, Severing Lash. It's not my favorite item, to be honest. And it's gonna be middle lane against this OD. We'll see how well he fares though. The Undying, very often, while I'm casting, tends to be quite useless in the fights. We'll see how useful he is. It's not that easy to run up at people when there's so many things impeding your movement. There is the Batrider Napalm, there is the Banish from OD. Why there's so many planes near my house today? I hope you guys don't manage to hear it because I got a directional mic and Old 11 just becomes cheeky with this OD, this Observer play. Drags the creep wave to the south there, even blocks the creep wave, but Bobokar is now here with the pin down and Burning might just get first blood. Old 11's gonna feed this first blood maybe. No, he TP's back home in the nick of time and he will actually bail himself out, but he does drag this creep wave under the tower, which is something. It is something else as well. Being able to avoid first blood and messing up the creep equilibrium here for Burning. You see Burning with the low damage on on his Husker will not be able to secure as many last hits as he would like. See, already missing one. See, it's looling under the tower. And the Boots of Speed not gonna lend any help to that. Meanwhile, Bubble Car is going to salvage the situation, pull it over the tomatoes, and have them clear out this wave. And with the tomato clap, should actually get rid of this wave. So IG fix their lane situation, and I missed first blood. My bad. Talking a little bit too much there. Blubbering. And yeah, I guess what happened there was Ehome actually does get pounced across and got that kill. So no biggie. XXS just feeds a kill over while his buddy. Buddy's failing the kill there, but meanwhile, Slark, okay, this is a little bit too much. He walks into the creep wave. Scylla is gonna survive there. The poor man's shield keeps him up, and the salve comes, and I thought that was gonna be a kill there, but no, sir, it was not. And in the end, well, no kills for him there, and now the OD, having used his banish, will not be able to avoid the static link, and we'll get some of his damage reduced there. But meanwhile, OP is gonna run towards Old Chicken there and fight him one-on-one. Fight me IRL. And Old Chicken with the low damage might not be able to contest this one. The prison does do a little bit of harassment, a little bit of jab here and there. But overall, not too bad. Boboka, about to hit level 2 now. Wish fulfilled. Got picked up that bounty rune yet. Level 2 very much needed on this hero. And Razor once again gonna be draining 42 damage away from the OD. Very, very nice to be able to deal with him this way. And preventing him from getting last hits, even though he does get the banish across, he can mess up with your last hits. It is still not going to be as effective in helping him get that damage. You already see how it's powerful. Oh, now they might dive here. They have Soul Rip as well. Plasma Field comes out, and there we go. A punch here from the Haste of Undying. We'll take out the E-Home mid laner. And it's now 1-1. We tie up the kill score, and we have Burning. Once again, chasing after this bat, trying to get that level 2 so that he can at least settle for the jungle. And again, with the lack of disables here, they waste a lot of the time here on IG. But it does cost him 100 gold now in terms of TPs. And still staying at level 1. So this Husker has been very, very pressurizing for this Batrider. Unable to do much here. And he's actually just gonna stack here with level 1 Firefly. Will he get the stack across? Nope! NC Lul. Old Chicken. Middle lane, how's he looking in terms of CS? 3-0, yep, getting absolutely dumpstered by this Razor, as we would say. And yeah, so far this Razor playing very well. There has been no rotations to punish this aggressive play, so the OD hasn't managed to really come back from this. And we'll see, the Razor still managing to get those denies off. Burning actually doing very well in spite of that early mess up there by the Batrider, topping the CS charts. And as Burning does Burning things, we rope to the top lane. Oh, that's great that you guys see the, you don't see the plane, so that, don't hear the plane, that's great. This new mic has a lot of directional directional input, is that how do I say it? Yeah. And it works well, so okay. Thank you for telling me that. But meanwhile, old 11. He clears out the wave, he gets that level 2, I think. Poor guy, is he level 2? Yes, he is level 2. So he may be able to actually look into the jungle now, which is great. And OP now in a little bit of trouble as he gets lifted back. Then the chilling touch might actually kill him off. And there we go, the freeze comes in, and then without the bailout, the punish. KS. So one of the better things about the new OD, being able to KS those frags. And yeah, of course, OD gonna really enjoy that one as he is still sitting at the 6-0 CS scoreline, not looking too hot against his Razor. So OP gets taken out. Looks like OP not so OP. As he gets that tri-gank there on that middle lane, running for the rune. But Burning, about to hit that sweet spot, the Ancient Apparition, only at that level 3. Burning, about to hit that level 6 with a quick omelet on the way. So, could be making some things happen, taking some objectives here, while Scylla remains at that level 4 with the constant sanking pressure. Well, look here, Q. As the boots of speed as well as the infused raindrop now, so they're looking for something here. Meanwhile, the Razor just continuously just sitting on this OD's face, just pressuring him back. And Old Chicken trying to go for some damage, but yeah, really, he's not gonna do much as he is unable to actually click the Razor out of lane. So no harassment coming out from his right clicks, only the banish to do some damage. So very annoying so far. The OD is sitting at a pretty low on that CS score. XXS actually getting 20 last hits for himself, so pretty fly here, actually, honestly. The Slark maintaining a good CS lead as well, 27 to the Husker 35, who has, well, to be fair, got some uncontested lanes, so can't really blame him for his outstanding performance so far. But really, what comes down to who wins this matchup is whether or not the AA Ice Blasts are on point, and whether or not the Husker can actually get a good enough snowball rolling. I really like this block of the stack coming in here, and IG will deny that one. Sylar, meanwhile, still going 1-on-1 against this Undying. Without the AA and the Rubick around, the slot can't hope to catch him, and using his pounce aggressively might not be the right idea. And looking at Razor again. Oh wait, let me turn on Dota TV. My thing, it's not on. Sorry guys in Dota TV. Hello guys in Dota TV. Yeah, sorry about that. Didn't hear. Didn't manage to turn on in time. But yeah, it should be okay now. And yeah, IG. Still going to be one kill behind. But right now, if you look at that gold graph, they are actually 2,000 gold ahead. So, pretty swag for them. Sylar, well, gotta get Barrowshock again. The hits coming out really, really powerful. As the Caustic Finale as well as the Barrowstrike combo is just really doing a lot of punch to him. The Shadow Dance will actually top him up pretty nicely as long as he stays out of creep vision, of course. But right now it's going to be a really passive start as the average will be taking more damage here from the Razor now at 4 ranks in Plasma Field. Just being annoying for now. Has that unstable current available in case he wants to mess with this OD. The armlet is done now for burning. Armlet against AA is always going to be a risky option, but you know, on Husker is almost needed, I would say. So it's going to start pressuring this tower. The glyph already forced out, but I do believe they will be able to get this tower with minimal contest. The Rubick is going to be coming down here, but he's only level 3 for now. It's not going to be easy to hold the line here. XXS though, on the other hand, is going to clear out an Observer Ward, so a small farm to him. How's he looking in terms of CS? We'll see if he goes Blink or that Arcanes first. Here it does depend. With this tier 1 tower, it is going to be a very, very easy push for him. It's already 7 minutes in, already taking his tier 1 tower here. IG.
Radiant's middle tower is under attack. Radiant structures.
Line. Meanwhile, OD taking his own opportunity to pressure this mid lane. And wow, the Sankin getting a kill here. It might get a second one as well. Wow, Raindrops keeping him alive. And XXS with the epicenter as well. Getting the kill there on two heroes. The Slark not expecting that turnaround. And very surprising he gets a solo kill. Honestly, there is no way he gets a solo kill there. But they go aggressively on him. And well, XXS, like I said, as I've been really impressed by his performance so far. The Raindrops keeping him alive from the initial burst and the Epicenter, as well as the Caustic being able to take out those heroes before. And now he even gets a Blink Dagger with that double kill and a tier 1 drop. That's a really early Blink Dagger for an offlane Sanking. 8 minutes in, we'll see if XXS can make anything out of this. It's a BO3. So, no. You use the crazy stuff, it's not a BO1, but stuff like that still happen. Immediately debuting that early Blink Dagger, and old chicken gets caught off guard there. It's like, what the hell? Probably gonna be pinging mid now, asking his supports or the safe lane. What the hell just happened as the Sanking reveals his 8-minute Blink Dagger? And wow. This tier 1 tower probably gonna fold as well. Q now with the 3 points in Tombstone. Looks like he is going for that path instead. And the Razor here with the Plasma Field gonna be able to clear out waves ASAP. And Q, if there's any kind of contest for this tower, they're probably gonna drop a Tombstone for that. Looks like it will not be the case, but the Sand King has something to say about this Rubick's interference though. The Plasma Field comes in, the Tombstone here to slow him as well, and the right clicks come in. The Razor will get the last taze across, and with that Tombstone zoning out some heroes, might look for another tower here. The Rubick's death will actually cost them, and IG amping up their aggression here, as they should, with a Razor lineup. Burning, meanwhile, gonna be showing his face here in the middle lane, skipping Lifebreak, actually. Very interesting, not having any heroes to kill, really. And this AA about to hit the level 6 mark. That's gonna be very important for him. Hitting that level 6 is the key point in this hero's pick. And Garda does strike level 6 at 10 minutes into the game. But the Purifying Flames have managed to buff up Burning to full now. So it's going to be a little rough to take him out. AA's Blast is good, but it's not the best. Not the best at level, without the Aghanim's upgrades. So we have to really keep an eye on these heroes for now. IG, they have an Invisible Sand King, and what more can you ask for having invisibility on your Initiator? Maybe even able to break out the smoke. The double damage OD is going to be a big deal, but Slap though, having used this ability, here comes the Epicenter channel. It's gonna come in right onto the Slark there. Sylar trying to bail himself out, pops his ulti, but no sir, XXS sees to the end of him, and that is going to be another big kill. Unfortunate that he walked right into that one, the invisibility rune. really able to help him posture aggressively. And now with their slot down for another 20 seconds, can Ehome hold this lineup? They hold this tower. They really want to, as they have put all their heroes here. Old Levin even coming in before that Blink Dagger is online. And IG, we're getting some perfect world. Oh no, we're getting perfect world, guys. Sorry, Burning is going to be swinging away at that tower. It's gonna be counter swing going on. I do not want to relog. Tomorrow Shrine goes on to two. I saw that one happening. We're gonna have to tombstone drop this one. The ice block is gonna be missing onto that Huskar. So the Huskar now has free reign. He saw that ultimate going down, and now he knows that this is the Huskar Tower. And old Lanham trying to run away, but Burning says no, shuts him down with the Undying. The Golem is ready, the Tombstone's ready, and now this is the kind of snowball lineup you're looking at. Snowball in full effect here as the Ice Blast, the middle, and well, it misses. Burning's like, cracks his knuckles, I'm going in, boys. Hold my beer. And, well, it's great that Perfect World decides to like during the fight, but now next while we're farming, so. Hopefully won't have that kind of spike again. If it does, I'll relock very quickly, and hopefully that solves it up. Yes, usually reconnecting does help. We'll just let that rest for now. 7,005 gonna be the net worth advantage for IG. No real surprise there. I think this is how an aggressive lineup is meant to be played. Oftentimes you see C teams try for the same tactics, or the lesser experienced C teams, and they actually fall apart because they actually just deviate from the main plan, not go for the farming. Not go for the pushing instead. Settle down the farm, miss those timing windows where their lineup's supposed to be active. Well, you see IG execute this perfectly. They attack the tier 1 tower at 6-7 minutes with the plasma field clearing wave. And just really, you know, put the screws in onto the opposing team. They decided to sit back and play a little bit more aggressive with more defensive off supports there. They have that ramp up time for the Batrider to actually get his Blink Dagger. Now, frantically trying to farm that up. It's gonna be a very hard task to do. Scylla halfway to his Shadow Blade, so really needs that before he can actually get something done. Meanwhile, the Undying himself already picking up that Shadow Amulet. The smoke now popped. They don't want to let up on any aggression. Scylla is going to Dark Pack now, and what a time to Dark Pack! The Burrow Strike comes in! This is such a bad time to Plasma Field as well. Scylla, you cannot, I repeat, you cannot do that. But now the Burrow Strike has been stolen. It's a dominating for the Sand King. It's 1,003 now. Does he go for Aether Lens, or does he go straight for that Aghanim Scepter? I imagine Aghanim will be a big problem for this slot. And well, popping that Dark Pact early was definitely not part of the plan here. IG, XXS might just do a blind blink here. They walk right into Lanham. Lanham gets spotted out, and there you go, the Tombstone drops, preventing any kind of real aggression coming in. Nice Barrel Strike though, will keep Lanham alive, so very happy to be able to pick up that ability there. Burning, meanwhile, gonna go for the tier 2, and I imagine they will be looking towards maybe a Roshan push after this one, or maybe go to defend that top tower, which they are. Razor coming in. Is there a Sand King here? Nope, just the Razor to clear out the waves. IG, do they head to the Rosh Pit? I think they do. There is an Observer Ward here, but I don't believe Ehome has any kind of contesting potential, especially if Old Levin just sitting at that 1,400 mark. They might be going in here with the Banish setup. Yep, they're going in. Old Chicken is perched. The TP's come in from the Sand King. This could be ill-advised here. They go with the Razor kill. Are they going to be able to get it? The Barrel Strike comes in. The Ice Blast will probably find a Razor. They get him with the Hammer, and XXS is going to be caught off guard here as the OD actually banishes himself, but Huskar has arrived. The Ice Blast has not been used to strike him, and then Burning goes to town on the other two heroes. So like I said, ill advised. You trade a mid laner and then some for your Batrider as well. So not super worth it, although the AA getting the snipe there does afford him his Midas. So that is an upside there for Ehome. But unfortunately, if you look at the net worth, it's just heavily favoring the IG squad right now. So you IG fans at home should actually be cheering a little bit. Meanwhile, the Hellbear Special surviving at 9 HP. They're getting killed by Skeleton Warriors. May he rest in peace. Tomato down. But Huskar still leading the pack there, as Burning usually does in the net worth department. Scylla again using his Dark Pack for farm. Might be pressed on here. Not gonna happen as he does back off. He's sitting at 2005 now, still thinking about whether to get that Shadow Blade early. We'll see if he does. Old Chicken in the meantime building towards that 4 star. The Banish is coming in. Again, IG, what's up here? 4-1 and 6 on the Sand King. IG Q, the Undying, has been putting a lot of work in recently, and the Epicenter coming in once again. It might be a little bit too early on the channel. Very unfortunate there for XXS. But then again, you don't take those dives, you don't get rewarded. And he got rewarded twice already with 2 consecutive slot kills. a third one airballing. Well, that is just unfortunate. Meanwhile, OP. Gonna be building an overclock. We'll see what it does come now. Probably a Dragon Lance. Could be an early BKB to offset some of that early magic. But Syla does pick up his Shadow Blade now, so could be looking at a snipe on certain heroes. Even Huskar isn't too out of the question. Old Chicken. Oh, I have to play a little bit careful here. The Rubick is there. The land is 8, but most of Ehome's lineup is here, so I don't believe Burning should be sticking around here, but he does seem to want to stick around. The Sand King is here already. Doesn't have that epicenter for another 60 seconds. The tier 2 tower looks like it's lost at this point, but I do really want to see if there are going to be any sentries here on this lineup or in this push. No sentries so far. I do not see them on Undying as well. Okay, he has one. So we'll see if he does plop those down. But it does seem like Ehome do not want to contest this. And will instead let this one go, try and take that tier 1 with old 11 and get his Blink Dagger up. He already has it, so might be a possibility here that they take the next fight. And the tower is going to go. So that's going to be a tower down here. Meanwhile, Slark going to get caught out. They do have some detection on him. No, they do not. The Shadow Blade will actually keep him alive. But they do deny the tower and deny Syla some more farm. Net worth still looking really hot there for IG fans and Burning. Dragonlance completed. Just really looking to be a force to be reckoned with. This Batrider. Slark actually going to TP out of there. The server wards keeping tabs on these IG heroes. Burning not really caring right now. Still sitting at that 1-0. And what are we looking at here, IG? Man, my throat's just killing me. Oh no, Syla just having the worst day! The Barrel Strike is gonna be stolen, I think. Yes, it is gonna be stolen. Barrel Strike there, Syla is gonna be able to escape this in time. The Undying, though, is doing some massive damage to Lanham here. No, the secondary Barrel Strike lands on 2 supports with the Decay as well. That is gonna be a shutdown there on the support lineup. 14-3, Ehome getting absolutely dunstered here in the bottom lane, and they will lose their last tier 2 tower. Meanwhile, this AA pick hasn't really worked out for them. The Sand King has just been too painful for them to deal with. This early Blink Dagger now 4-star even adds so much reach to this Scorpion and even stealing the Siege Creep. So we got double Carti here. Gonna be pressuring this tier 3 tower, and I'm not even sure what Ehome can do about this. If it's, there's gonna be a swing around, this is the time to do it. And looks like they will actually build out now with the black back out. Oh, 11 still thinking about pulling a backliner. Will he actually find the target though is the question. This is very dangerous for him to actually go on. And he looks like he will actually rethink his life choices and not go for something as dangerous as that. But looks like IG are not done just yet. They do the good old bait and switch. Old 11, will he actually be, in fact, a victim of this hate crime that's going to be coming in? This Scorpion just waiting for all 11. It's like, come on, where are you farming? Razor's out. Fine, no one going to bite. We're going to come back in again. We've just topped up and like, you know, this is a key point in our fight here. We can actually take this very easily. And OP just showing himself the OD. Going to be vanishing a creep. Last one comes out again. There's not the creep wave up. Old 11 actually very lucky not to get tagged here, but it looks like they are going in. Maybe to catch Razor here. The Blink Dagger is ready. They will catch Razor, but the Purge, though, is a big counter over to this Razor. Will they be able to catch him, though? He has that regeneration. So this Ice Blast is going to land. Will it land in time? No, it will. It will actually miss. It misses. The Oracle comes with a bailout, and they waste their lasso. So I'm not sure what they were planning to do with that pull, but yeah, the Razor makes it very difficult for you to drag him back. The Purge lasts a little bit too long, and now Roshan getting done really quickly here with the Undying Golem, just adding up all the damage. And yeah, the Amplification often forgotten on that Flash Golem. And now Huskar, without that Ice Blast of Fear, he will be taking his Aegis to find a dandy, and now you only have one. The Barrel Strike is going to come onto the Batrider, who has been lurking in the sidelines there. Gonna get hit by that plasma field as well. The slow comes in. I don't believe he will be getting out. No, sir. The purifying flames will actually nuke him down low enough for Burning to secure that last hit there. Shoots the bat out of the sky. And now we're looking at Ehome on the run here as Old Chicken. Almost regretting, I think, not banning that Huskar. You know, it's very. You know, these are the kind of games where you, like, you know, you draft and everything's fine and dandy, and then all of a sudden, like, the Huskar comes on the fifth pick and like, oh yeah, we forgot about that. And then, you know, you kind of have that sinking feeling where, you know, right, we can pick this AA, but it's still not the best, especially now that Burning has an Aegis. We only have one Ice Blast. It's gonna be a problem for sure. And Burning, doing the smart thing, doing the face tanking of sitting at the front lines there, not gonna be caring about what happens there, even dodging that Astral Imprisonment, daring the OD to come in nearer, the Sand King just waiting for a moment. There is still that slot with a Silver Edge though, so they could take out the Huskar's ability now. He's going in for the break in, and we are going in with that kill. The Huskar immediately loses his Aegis, so that is not the most pristine usage of that ability. Garda still holding on to that Ice Blast here, coming in now with it, but the Oracle with the save, the saving here will actually build him out. Now the Steel comes out, he hex turns himself into a Flash Golem, the second Air Ball epicenter here of this game, and IG gonna look to pressure this Rex. They probably will get it as all the ultimates are down now. All the big ones anyway, the melee Rex is falling, the Undying Tombstone just being too oppressive here in this lane. Old Lanham just charging up with his Undying Golem, but it's still not good enough for him, and the IG squad secure Rex at 21 minutes. Now we're gonna retreat for more farm, get some items up, and then come back in with even more firepower. This Huskar sitting at 3,500 gold. I wonder what he's gonna build now. It's looking pretty scary, and I love this Aether Lens pickup on this Oracle, a true bubble car indeed. Gonna be able to purify flames as well as False Promise from a mile away, keeping the Huskar safe and sound always. So, like I said, AA Ice Blast level 1, not the most effective against Huskar, because the Oracle will be able to stop that shadow damage from happening, because the health points do not drop while you're under Oracle's ulti. And also, the fact that the duration is almost the same. So if you're attacked by Ice Blast and then the False Promise goes on you, if the Ice Blast wears off after the ultimate, so whatever healing you get during False Promise does heal you anyway. It only doesn't heal if you're still Ice Blasted while False Promised. So it's still looking really bad here for Ehome. And well, it's looking rough. Old Chicken, he's farming bottom, trying to get that tier 1 pressure on. While IG are looking to get that second set of Rex here. We might be looking at a quick game 1 in this BO3 of the Dota Pit Season 5 Chinese qualifier. And yeah, not looking too hard here for them. Huskar picks up a Sanji here. Radiant pressure. This time doesn't have the Aegis, so a potential for a bigger death here could happen against the Kofi. That's gonna slow him down a little bit. Turns off the armlet. Doesn't want to waste too much hit points. We're gonna lose his catapult. Oh, he finally gets a tower. Round of applause for Old Chicken. He has had a rough game. 1-4. OD doesn't fare well against Razor, unfortunately. And it looked like Razor actually did go back to that early BKB, just wanting to get that pressure on, get into those early fights. And yeah, so far it's been working out pretty fly for them. Has already popped his ultimate and dying. Having a human cape is obviously going to be a big deal. Even pick up the buckler here. Might just go for the guard. Here comes the tombstone once again. Old Chicken might want to be looking to press this, but I think it's so ripped for that. So ripped? Nope. Not going to be so ripped for that. We're going to not keep the tombstone alive. But a banish now onto that hero. The Huskar going in onto Old Lanham. The Ice Blast will come in. But again, the Oracle keeps things flying here. Old Chicken going to melt. I do believe Burning will die. I might be wrong about this. Nope, I am not wrong. He is going to die. The buybacks come out. Plenty here for Ehome. Will they be able to survive there? Their flame break no longer cancels TP. Doesn't matter anyway. It's 5 seconds on cooldown. XXS is gonna burst strike away. He has to blink in 2-1. Does he blink out in time? No, yes he does. He actually blinks out away in time, and XXS just keeping things there to the second. And the slot once again gonna be killless in this game. Sylar just looking so hard for these kills. And this is why 4-3k pups should just take note and see how Slark is absolutely useless in certain pro games when he gets hard countered. And Sylar, the Silver Edge may be online for him, but he has gotten no kills out of this. Not even support kills. The Oracle has been staying out of trouble. Bobokar sitting at a very sweet 1-0. And, looking at a Q here, what's he gonna buy? Is this probably gonna be a mech? I would like to see, no, I mean a Crimson Guard will be cute, but I do believe he'll be a mech. He's not that farmed to afford a Crimson Guard. But yeah, XXS is now going to go in 5-1 on the Sand King. But if you look at the kill score, it's just pretty much that, you know, it's surpassing 12,000 mark now. Sylar looking for another pick, but it's really hard to find a pick when they're always grouping together as 5, smoking up together, and having the Huskar lead the charge. So we'll see if the play is to push some more, or wait till that Roshan respawns. I think right now IG are just reluctant to give any kind of space to Yihome to recover. And the Sand King is going to break the dagger here. And is it going to be a rush strike? He will find it. Let him. Oh, finds the wrong side and will not actually get the TPing heroes. But unfortunately for Slop, he has not actually run away. And he does get spotted here. The Eul Scepter will scout him out. Is there going to be another barrel strike? The Dark Pack will secure him. But now the Link will actually find him. And I don't believe there is going to be a secondary stun here. So they will not be able to catch him off guard. The Dark Pack is going to be in time here. But OP does get a little bit of damage out of Slop. 105 to be exact. Burning. He's gotten himself a Heaven's Hailbird. And I can't say I disagree. Adds to that pressure. Adds to that tankiness, the evasion. Already going to be a problem here for the Slark. And yeah, Life Break is not something Rubick excels at doing. Maybe for a kamikaze kind of play. So we'll see if he does decide to go hams in. But the break now coming in onto that Razor. So instead of that Husker losing his Berserker's Blood, will be Razor losing his Purge for just a couple of seconds. But now he's going to be back. The Undying Tombstone is going to be placed further back to prevent any kind of advances from Yihome. But at the same time, keeping a nice battle front here for IG. They are striking hard at the Rexes, and it looks like Yihome have no responses. I'm just kidding here. Here comes the pull here onto that Burning. Oracle, does he bail him out? Yes, he does. Oracle bails out Burning on his Husker. It looks like Husker says, I'm all dead. I'm going all in. And he's going ham. He goes ham onto Sylar. Does he get the kill? He even gets the heal off Oracle. Oles Frog. There's a lot of damage in. Does Husker buy back into this? No, he does not. They managed to hold. It looks like Yihome will hold the line here. With the pulls, they do not lose any key buyback or non-buyback heroes as they have expended that in the last fight. So they will actually keep a healthy Rex count after that engagement. Will not be able to secure another one. So Husker falls and they immediately fall back there. I kind of agree that, you know, IG don't want to take any more extra losses to amp up the net gain for Yihome. It looks like the net worth has stagnated a little bit now. So Yihome will keep at it. Try and keep the game going. They might be a Rex down, but they're still not giving up. You know, this discipline of theirs is just going to be keeping and taking the best fights possible as their lineup will allow. And old 11 is still trying to go for that farm. The 4-star has been a big booster for him. Being able to pull a singular target into the back lines there. Very important. And it looks like IG are not letting up now. Husker is back and they're looking for another round. If they take another swing and kill off either OD or maybe a Slark, I think none of them have buybacks. Slark has a buyback. I think Rubick bought back. Yeah, Rubick as well as the OD bought back. So any of those heroes go down again in the next fight, they are not going to be able to come back to this match. So Yihome, they have to play this one very carefully. The lasso is off cooldown. All their ultimates, Radiant's thankfully, are very short cooldown ultimates. But so are the ones on IG. All of them are on now. This is ready and burning. Now going for the more. Yeah, there you go. Hurricane Pike things. Going on here, but yeah, the Rage Barracks is going to be taking some permanent damage here. It doesn't come back, and I like the sentry wall placement. It does keep the Slark in check, and looks like they want to go for Burning again, but Burning is not going to allow that. He's going to strike that Rage Barracks down. He's going to go down. Okay, but now the lasso comes out. Is that going to be a bailout? But no, the Sand King says no. The Oracle, once again, going to be bailing out Burning, but Burning going to go onto some heroes, try and take as many people with him as possible. Garda is going to melt to the flame. Will he get brought down? No, he will not. The Batrider will survive. They lose the Rage Strike. They lose Husker again. They trade one for one, but it's still a hold here from Yihome. They get the gold they need, and I do like this call. I would say it favors Yihome for sure. And IG, let's look at teamfight recap. They get an 800 swing. It's not the biggest because they lost Rex as well. So it's a slow and painful way here. The rest of the team gets gold for the Rex kill. Burning stays at the top. I think once he gets that BKB, it's gonna be hard to kill him off. It's gonna be super hard to kill him off. Sylar, meanwhile, has managed to afford himself a BKB. This is why this guy is one of the top farmers in China. And, he's gonna look for the Razor kill, but is he gonna be able to do it? Just a break, maybe try and bait out a BKB. It looks like they're going smoking. Maybe trying to catch this 10-second window where the Husker is down and maybe play on the fact that Yihome are going to... Yeah, I'm just going to play. Okay, whoa, there you go. The Eul Scepter going to start on the OD, and that's going to be a Barrel Strike to land on this OD. He does not have a Blink Dagger. He doesn't have a BKB. He only has that Hurricane Pike. And like I said, attacking while this Husker is in the grave there. Well, just playing on the fact that Yihome might have their guard down while thinking that, okay, they won't move out without a Husker. We'll just try and chill Maybe farm a little bit on the map here, but nope. IG, attack 10 seconds early, catch E home with the pants down, and now OD caught without the buyback. We have 50 seconds on the sidelines without that. It's gonna be an Aegis for Burning, and this time it will be an easy one to secure. Hopefully Burning doesn't miss toggle. And Ice Blast letting all five heroes there. Now, ooh, nice lasso! Gonna be catching that Undying. We're gonna kill him off, but a bailout here from this Oracle will probably keep this Undying alive. The Ice Blast will not kill him off, and the heal comes in with a Soul Rip as well. Something to note, just kidding, he dies. Just the Soul Rip not going on himself, but the Brown Strike coming in. But now they have used the Lasso though, on that Undying. All 11 doesn't have any outs against this Husker. The Plasma Heal comes out, the BKB will secure it. Lanham trying to stay in the fight there with his friends. Bobokar trying to run away. Does he get the disarm off here on himself? No, he still keeps himself alive there in the Slark. That's overcommitting using his ulti and his jump now. He doesn't have any runs away from the Sand King, but they don't have any detection as well. So they're going in there. The Husker doesn't have the Aegis. Gets tagged by the Ice Blast and he actually gets brought down. Syla holding the line here so far against his opponents. 21-9. Eholm starting to claw back into this game with three crucial kills there and a half health. Roshan, I'm not sure they can take this one easily without any kind of damage reduction. The catapult comes, scouts them, and oh, looks like Slark is going for it with that Hyperstone online. He really wants to take a gander at this Roshan. The Golgrove slowly dipping down. Eholm showing the resilience of a Boston invited team. And will they manage to pull this game back? They have had some really beneficial fights the past few rounds. And how many bouts more can they go for? We'll have to see. This game might just be going the distance here, guys. Garda, with that Aghanim Scepter upgrade, it's going to be a big deal now against the Husker. He needs that Aegis. He needs it. Alright. 2,800 gold on gold 11. They are steadily getting better fights going on here. Meanwhile, the Slark just showing everyone why he's Ice Frog's favorite hero. Never nerfed, only buff. Always on B. Alright, here we go. We're gonna be smoking S4 again. Gonna keep that Husker on the map there. Try and lower the guard there off the E-Home squad. Again, the OD using Vanish for defensive purposes. Gonna get Barrel Strike. Oh no, the Ice Blast already used there for an offlane strike. And now Olchek is gonna get Epicenter here by the 4-star usage. That's too much. And the self-banish on the OD, keeping himself on ice for now. Is that gonna be a kill? The Slark is back. He gets disarmed there. He immediately gets Barrel Strike back up into the fight. But OP takes out the OD. Realizes that the OD self-banished himself. Man, actually trapping himself in the claws of IG. And now without buyback, this OD might not be able to come back in time, having just bought his item, the Perseverance, on himself. The Husker is ready with his grin on his face. He is looking to press this mid-rax down. And Eho might have just made a colossal mistake in terms of defense, purchasing out those items, leaving themselves defenseless. The AA, no buyback as well. Will not be able to ice buff for 9 seconds. This Rex looks all but gone. There is a glyph to keep things, well, keep things alive for now, but the AA, will he be able to fight in time though? The Batrider does have a pull, but I don't think they will be keeping this mid-rax alive, and IG gets away with murder here. 24-9, just when things were looking up for Eholm, IG strike back with a no. And now they look for the Roshan again. The Ice Blast is always going to be a threat though, so I'm not sure they will be able to do it. Maybe they wait a few seconds, maybe bait out that Ice Blast, but unfortunately there is that Observer Ward, so it's gonna be a problem for sure. They're going in for the Roshan. The Ice Blast is still not gonna be flying in just yet. It's gonna be a smoke out here from Eholm. And they know. And IG knows. IG knows. But so do Eholm. Eholm knows that IG knows. And whoa, whoa, this Observer Ward is gonna be prime. Out of vision for now. There's gonna be a lasso. They pull in the Oracle. And this is the kill they need. But oh no, Syla makes a big boo-boo. He misses on that jump. And now Syla takes a whopping amount of damage. And the Ice Blast will fly. It's gonna be completely airborne, only landing on the Undying. Meanwhile, Razor in the back lines going to town here, getting banished by the OD in the nick of time. But meanwhile, Slark is nothing but dust as the Sand King finds him. This OP Razor, so strong. They're striking four Eholm heroes down. And the GG comes out. And I don't say I'm surprised. That was a huge turnaround here from IG. They take out the kills. I mean, they were working so hard to deal with the Husker, they forgot that Razor is actually pretty strong as well. I mean, after all, that guy made TI4 unbearable for some teams. And IG, they'll take game one against Eholm, and in spectacular fashion here with a Husker lineup. But I would say that was all on eHomes. Oh no, all on IG's Razor. OP, their mid laner, their Sand King, outstanding plays. And well, I know you eHome fans want to see a second chance at swinging back at IG, and me too. You know, as a best of three, things could go either way. IG, they have this game in the bag, but do they have two? They need two to progress and to knock eHome into the lower bracket. So we'll see if that happens. We'll be right back with game number two very shortly. Don't go anywhere. I'm Lysander Zanora, and you're watching Dota Pit Season 5. Much love and Kappa.